Yeah, now the session has been recorded. So that's how, like, I'll be keeping you all on mute. Then once I discuss the topic for 40 to 45 minutes, then after the session, you can actually ask the questions. In the meantime, also, you can ask the questions on the chat window, or and if it is related to the topic, I'll answer then and there, or else, like, we'll park the question and we'll take up at the end of the session. And end of the sessions, if you still have any questions, you can raise your hand. I can unmute you. You can speak out. You can speak out. So that's how our training sessions will go on. And I'll be the trainer for this session and the entire course as well. Let's start with the agenda for today's session. And before going to start the agenda, I want to make sure, like, even if you are a fresher or if you are working as a manual tester and if you want to change it to automation testing, and if you are new to IT industry, don't worry. So we'll start from very basic. I'll start from very basic and make sure that you are clear on the topics. All right, let's start the agenda for today. So today's agenda is, like, we'll discuss what software testing is and what are the different types of testing, what are the challenges in manual testing, and then how automation tools work and how we can use them to overcome the manual testing challenges. Then we'll briefly discuss on what Selenium automation tool is about. Then we'll cover what are the advantages and limitations of Selenium. And finally, we'll also see, like, why Selenium has become more popular and has more demand in the market. And we'll also cover, after that, we'll also cover, like, what we'll learn from this course and what you'll also get from each session. After each session, what you'll be getting. So that will be discussed. And finally, we'll have Q&A at the end of the session. All right, hope you are clear with the agenda. So let's start now. So what is software testing? So even before starting what software testing is, let's define what software is. So a software is a collection of programs. A program is a set of instructions given to a system to achieve a particular task. So that we call it as a program. And many such programs combinedly, we call it as a software. That is what a software means. And what is a software testing? So understanding software testing, let's take an example. So for example, you want to buy a mobile phone. So what do you see? Actually, you note it down all the requirements. So whatever functionalities or whatever features you want, so you list it down. And within your budget, you go to a shop or you search online whether you are actually able to get the your requirement within your budget and buy a nice mobile, right? And once you buy the mobile, you install your favorite app. And let's say, for example, you, after installing this application or app on the mobile, you try to open the application and just imagine it doesn't open and it just crashes. So just imagine how you feel. You feel frustrated, right? So why this happened? So the software was developed and it was, like, installed in the mobile application, but it was not getting open, meaning, like, it was not tested. It was not tested for its quality. So let's with that, let me define testing. So it was not tested, and that's the reason you are seeing the application not being working. So let's define what testing is. So evaluating the quality of a software. If it meets the requirement, if it is meeting our requirement or not. So this is how we can define the testing. So what software testing is? So we are evaluating the software, and we are checking whether it is meeting the requirement, desired requirement or not. So that is what testing is. So once you test the software, if you feel that it is working according to the requirement, then we can release the product. Then people can use it, people can use it, the application, without any issues or problems. So that's the reason testing is important. Now, Coming to the types of testing, what are the types of testing we have? So the types of testing, we have two types of testing. One is manual testing, other is automation testing. Manual testing is what like a human can perform on the system, that we call it as manual testing. And automation tool is like mimicking the human actions just to test the software, is called automation testing. So these are the two types of testing we have. Now, let's actually understand what are the challenges in the manual testing. So what would be the challenges in the manual testing? So we understood like manual testing is what like testing a software by a person or a human, right? So what would be the challenges in the manual testing? First one is retesting. So what retesting means? Retesting means, so let's say for example, let me open a browser and explain you. Say for example, we have an application and you, let's say for example, we have two fields, username and password. Say for example, this is username and this is password. We have two fields. We wanted to test this application, which has two fields, username and password. Also, let's say for example, we have a login button here. So how do you test this application? Say for example, how do we test it first of all? So we provide some username, you provide password and you click on login, right? So in that case, how do you say that whether this test is passed or not? So if you are able to log in successfully with the correct username and password, then you say that this test is working properly, or this feature or this functionality is working properly. So in this case, like not only this, so you can test this same login screen with multiple inputs as well, right? So say for example, with username and password, so say for example, I give valid username first, and then say for example, I give a valid username and valid password. So what is our expectation? It has to pass, right? It has to pass. What should happen if I provide the username valid one, but I provide a password incorrect one? So in that case, the test case has to fail. In the same way, we can derive more number of test cases, like what happens if I provide username invalid and password as correct, and also if what happens if I provide both username and password as invalid one. Invalid in the sense that is not correct for the login. So in all the cases, the test case has to fail. This is what our expectation is. This is what we are testing for. So not only this, you test for a blank username and you provide a correct password, then you provide the blank username, but you provide the wrong password, what error you get in that case. Like this, there we can derive more number of test data. This is called test data. So we have the feature fields here, and you wanted to test that fields or that this test, whether it is working correctly or not. And to test that, you can have like multiple ways of testing. This is called as multiple test data. So what we are doing here, trying to work out with multiple test data and checking whether the application or this functionality of the login screen is working correctly or not according to our expectation. So if you give provide wrong username and wrong password, it has to fail, meaning the test has to fail. If it is failed, then according to our expectation, it is our test case is passed. So that's how we will be testing this small application. But if you see here, we have like many multiple test data. We are executing the same test, but with multiple set of test data. So say for example, for only these two fields, we have multiple set of test data, right? Say in some applications, there can be many fields, like it can go, say for example, 10 fields or 20 fields where you need to provide input. In that case, it will be massive. So the input test data will be massive. So how do you actually test it? So in this case, at least username and password, even if you get some 8 or 10 test cases, you might actually work it out in test it in 2-3 minutes manually. But if your input fields becomes like more, or 10 or 20, maybe 100, even some applications have many inputs like 100 fields. In that case, this will be a tedious job for any manual tester to work on this, to test this application with multiple test data. So what we are like, we need a lot of time, and we also need to spend, it will be a lot of effort as well. So it takes a lot of time as well as more effort to complete the testing the functionality of the application. So this is the main challenge in the manual testing. So what is that? So that is called retesting. So retesting is testing the software with multiple test data. So we are executing the same test case. Testing the same test case with multiple test data. So this is called retesting. And why this has become a challenge for us? So this has become a challenge for us as the number of test data grows. This will take more time to execute, and this will also involve more effort there. So this is the challenge in manual testing. And other challenge in the manual testing is regression testing. What regression testing is, we'll see. So before understanding regression testing, you need to understand like the real-time environment, how real-time environment will be. So how a software will be developed. So there will be two teams collaborating, mainly working when we develop a software in or a product in an IT industry. So the two teams are called development team. So the development team, the objective of development team is to develop the software, and the testing team or a QA team. So QA is quality assurance team. So whenever I say QA, it is like testing team. So there are like two teams. The objective of QA team is to test the quality of the product so that it has no defects in it and working as the expectation or according to the desired requirement. So these are the objectives of development team and the QA team. And say for example, the development team. So development team develops the software by writing the code or programs. Again, so what code is? Code is again the set of instructions. So they actually write the code of instructions, set of instructions that we call it as code or programs. And these programs are like built are internally tested by the dev team. So the internal tested by the dev team, that we call it as unit testing. And say for example, there are like maybe if a software might have like 20 or 10 features, say for example 10 features. So what are features called? Features or functionalities are like say for example, if you take a banking application, so logging into the banking application might be one feature, and you view the account balance, that might be one feature. You add a beneficiary and then you do the funds transfer. All these are like functionalities, or we call it as features. So all these features collectively makes a product or a software. So let's say for example, there are like 10 features. All 10 features will not be developed by a development team in one go. So they develop it like develop it in multiple cycles, or we call it as builds. So one they might take like maybe two features, that we call it as builds. So a build is a collection of programs written to achieve one or more features. So say for example, what is a build? Development team actually takes the programs, and they can't actually give it to the QA for testing the software as they write. So they actually take the code and build it. So build and provide an integrated environment or a build. A build can be an installer. So whatever you get it as an exe, right? So you don't actually see the code or program what is written in there. to develop the software. You just install it, right? So that is what we call it as build or cycle. So development teams, once they develop the features, so they actually convert that code or programs into a build or a cycle, or a, we can call it even a version even. So that's how development team does coding and gives a build to the QA team to actually validate the quality of the features. And as discussed, all the features might not be given in one time. So say for example, in cycles, right? So in the first build, maybe development team, say for example, they provide two features to QA. Now, what should a QA team do? So the objective of the QA team is to actually validate the quality of the software, right? So what does even before validating the software, what they do is QA team should have a test plan where they will actually plan what are the resources like required, and they understand the requirement of the product, and they write the scenarios, test case scenarios, and convert them into the test cases. So a test case is just a step-by-step action you perform, like how we performed. So in order to test this username and password, what could be the possible steps here? So the step one could be logging in into the application using the URL of the application. And then you provide the username, then you provide a password. These are all the step-by-step actions we are doing to actually test a small piece of a software, right? Then you click on login. These are all like step-by-step actions. So then you actually verify if it is you are getting the expected result or not. This is called a test case. So what testers do is they actually write the test cases. So they prepare the test cases, how to test the application. So test cases are like step-by-step actions written to perform on the application to test the features of the application. So that's how they actually test the software, right? So in how, like then once dev team gives the some features as a build to the QA team, they take the build and install it in the in their machines. Like it can be an installer, so they install it on their machine, QA team, and they test. So they already wrote some test cases, right? Say for example, the two features might have like 20 test cases, and they execute these test cases. And if there are any defects or issues with the test cases, then they report it to the dev team. These defects will be reported to the dev team. Say for example, out of the 20 test cases, only 15 test cases worked and five fail. So these five failed test cases will be reported to the development team to work on. Then what development team does is they actually pick up these five failed test cases, they fix the five failed test cases, and also provide some new features in build 2. So they actually provide build 2 with some more features, and also they fix the five failed test cases which QA team reported in build 1. So now what development team does is, along with the fixes, five fixes, they also provide, let's say for example, two more features. Now QA picks up the build again. So what they need to verify, first of all, they need to verify the five fixes. And then they also need to verify the two new features which were developed newly in the build 2. Say for example, you have 30 test cases again for the two new features. And also along with this, so we need to test other test cases. So those are like the 15 test cases which actually worked on build 1. So this also needs to be tested, because so on fixing these five test cases or introducing new 30 test cases, the existing functionality or whatever has been worked like in the build 1 15 test cases was worked and passed successfully, right? So these test cases should not be broken or should not be failed as there was new fixes or new features introduced in build 2. So making sure that the existing functionality is not broken while testing a build is called a regression testing. So what is a regression testing is like, we make sure that the existing functionality is not broken when some fixes or some new features are introduced into the build is what we call it as a regression testing. Now, what is the challenge in regression testing? So what's the challenge? So we can do this manually, right? So build one came, so QA team picked up, so they executed 20 test cases, reported 5, this is fine. Then they picked up build 2, they verified the 5 fixes, and they wrote like 30 test cases, new test cases. Those test cases are like executed manually. And again, this, if you observe, again, these 15 test cases are repeated, which are already passed, will be executed again. And also, say for example, there is another build 3. There is a build 3 where you get more number of features again. So where there are more number of features. Say for example, you get 3 features here now. And QA team might have again, say for example, 50 test cases, new test cases. These are new test cases for these 3 new features has been developed by QA team. Now, only these 50 test cases are not enough to be executed on build 3. You need to execute your 20 test cases on the build 1 and the new and the 30 test cases which you executed on build 2 also needs to be executed here on build 3. So if you observe, so this is all repetition of work. Say for example, this is only build 3 and we have only 10 features. Say for example, there might be multiple builds coming up, 20 or 30 builds, and in each build there can be many features, and each feature might add up another like multiple test cases, and in each test build, if you observe, the repetition is more. So whenever you executed some test cases in build 1, that is repeated in build 2, and in build 3, if you observe, all the test cases which are fine and which are not working are also executed on build 3 again. So in multiple builds, if you observe, the complexity will be more. The more number of test cases will be executed manually. So this becomes like again a tedious job. So if you observe, so already which are all working, we are actually testing them just to make sure there is no regression in the builds. So this is what we are doing, and this is a big challenge. So and again, this involves a lot of time. If you see, this involves effort as well. So what we are doing here, so we are executing the new test cases as well as the old test cases which are already working on the previous builds, but we wanted to make sure that there is no regression with the new features added or new fixes added. We are actually testing them again and again. So testing again and again the same test cases just to make sure there is no regression is called as regression testing. And this we can see here, as the build numbers grow, the complexity will also be grown. And this involves a lot of time and a lot of effort when doing as manual testing. So these are the main challenges like while performing the manual testing. So regression testing is performing performing the same test again and again. Again and again, just to make sure existing functionality is not broken. This is how we can actually define regression testing. So now, how do we address this? Like how we address this anyway with the automation tools. But before that, we need to understand how automation tools work. Let's understand how automation tools work. So say, for example, how automation tools work. You have AUT. So AUT is called application under test. So how do you test it? How do you test an application if done manually? Say, for example, there is a test case. So each test case, as we know, it has like multiple steps. We know, right? Test case is a step of actions. So this is your test case. And we have a manual tester. Say, for example, we have a manual tester. Who is a manual tester? So this manual tester, what he does, each step, he reads each step in the test case and executes. This is called AUT. AUT is application under test. This is the application we wanted to test. So manual tester, what he does, he picks up each test step and then he actually executes on the application under test. So that's how a manual tester tests the application. This is how the manual testing works, right? So in the same way, how automation tool works. Let's understand how automation tool works now. So the same test case will be there. So the same number of steps will also be there. But if you observe, like the automation tool, right? Say for example, this is same your application under test. And then you have an automation tool here. So how automation tool does this? So anyway, it has to read the test steps, as test case is a collection of steps. So it needs to read each step and execute on the application, right? So how it does? So we need to provide the tool set of instructions to read these steps which are written in the test case. So it has to read each steps written in the test case and perform the testing on the application. So how does the tool know, reading the steps in the written in the test case? So if it is like manual, right? If it is a human, he can read it. If it will be in the plain English, right? So he can read each step and he can perform the same steps on the application. But how about tool? It can't understand English language or English language as is, right, in the plain. So it has to be instructed. So a set of instructions has to be given to the tool so that it can perform what the test case actually says. And this set of instructions, we give it to the tool with the help of a programming language, as any automation tool understands programming language. So this is the medium for the tool to understand whatever you write. And in the programming language, you write it scripts. We don't call it as steps or test case. We write the scripts. In the programming language, we write the scripts. So tool needs to understand. So that's the reason we need to provide it a set of instructions to execute all these steps which are written in the test case. And these set of instructions can be provided to the tool using a programming language, as any tool, automation tool, not only Selenium, any automation tool, it can only understand its own programming language. And each tool depends on supports different types of programming language, but this is mandatory. So this is the medium for any tool to actually understand the set of instructions. That's the reason programming language is very, very important. So so Java is a programming language. We are actually going to concentrate, learn Java more, like in the coming sessions, in the coming 2 weeks, we'll mostly concentrate on Java programming language, and we'll learn Java, whatever required for to start with Selenium. So I hope you are clear on this. So we write the scripts using the programming language, which tool can understand to actually read the test steps and perform the actions on the application. So this is the use of the automation tool and how automation tool works. Now, how automation tool can overcome the manual testing challenges that we'll see. So what were the manual testing challenges? So there were like retesting and regression testing. Let's see how automation tool can work on, or how it can solve the manual testing challenges, right? So say again, you have like application on, say for example, retesting. Retesting, you provide the multiple test data in an Excel sheet. You provide multiple test data in an Excel sheet, as retesting involves multiple test data, and you have your application under test. So this is your application. So, and you write your automation scripts here. So you write the scripts once, and this, what this script or the automation tool, this is the tool, and you write the scripts here. What this tool does is it reads multiple input from the your Excel sheet and performs the application under test. So you can provide any number of test data here in the Excel, as we saw here when we were looking into username and password test case. So we saw that, right? So there can be multiple test data, but script once written, so it reads the test data one by one and executes on the application, and it's very fast, as it is the tool or the automation which does it. So it does very fast. That's how like we can actually overcome the challenge of retesting. And now, so how do we actually overcome the challenge of regression testing? So in the same way, so if you observe here, this was the use case we were talking for the regression test, right? So regression test was to make sure the existing functionality should not be broken. So what is the existing functionality in our use case? So these 15 test cases was the existing functionality to the build tool, and whatever executed here successfully becomes the successful criteria for the build 3. These are the successful test cases executed in the previous builds. These test cases we are repeating and testing again and again. So what we can do here is like automation script, we can write once and run many times, as we can write the script once but can be executed with multiple test data in the same way. So what we do is we also take this 20 test cases or 15 test cases and automate it before build 2 comes. So when we automate this 15 test cases or write scripts for these 15 test cases, then what happens? So in the build 2, we can only concentrate on the fixes, 5 fixes and the 30 new test cases. So that you can perform manually, but if you observe, these 15 test cases which you already executed on build 1 need not be executed again manually. You already wrote a script for this, so you just need to execute the script, that's it, and that doesn't take a lot of time. So you already wrote the script, you just need to execute it, and even the execution of this 15 test cases using the script also doesn't take much time, as it is executed by the automation tool. And see, for example, in the build 3, you'll again automate this 30 test cases in build 2, and when you come to build 5, you will only concentrate on the 50 new test cases manually, but the already to be executed 50 test cases existing functionality can be covered using the scripts. So that's how we will actually overcome the challenge of regression testing. So what we discussed here, let me recap it again. So how we overcome regression testing is, so regression testing is like to make sure the existing functionality should not be broken. For that, what we are doing is whatever test cases we executed manually once, that test cases can be automated using the tool or using any automation tool by writing the scripts, and these scripts can be executed in the upcoming builds. Just you run the scripts and you don't need to do it manually again. And what are the new test cases for that build? You execute it manually only once. So what we are achieving here is all the test cases you are doing it manually once before your release. So all these 10 features makes it your product, right? That is called as integrated product. So once all these features are done, we done a system testing. So before we release the product or the software to the customers. So that's how the automation tool will be very handy, like overcoming the challenge of regression testing. Right. So the how automation tool works and like the challenging is also discussed now. Now let's understand how like Selenium automation, what Selenium automation tool is and how it works, right? So what Selenium is? So Selenium is a collection of components. It's not one component, it's a collection of learning. Selenium is, it's a collection of components. You learn a collection of components while actually learning Selenium. And Selenium was introduced by Jason Huggins when he was working for ThoughtWorks company. So when Jason Huggins was working for ThoughtWorks in 2004, he was actually developing the web-based application. And before that, there was only like a desktop or Windows application. In the early 2000s, the web-based applications came into existence. So before that, let me discuss what are the different kinds of applications we have. So different, what are the different kinds of applications we have? So one is desktop or Windows applications. So these are the applications which are like executed or installed on your machine. Say for example, you have the installer, you install it on your machine once. And these don't need like browser or web. Say for example, your MS Word, your calculator on your machine, your MS PowerPoint, or your media player, all these are called Windows applications or the desktop applications. So these are like installed once on your machine and doesn't require internet connection to work. So if you install on your machine, you can use the applications without even connected to the internet. These are called as Windows applications. Later came the web-based applications. So these are the web-based applications. So what web-based applications are is, so a server will be running in a remote location and you will be provided an URL. And that URL, you access it from any browser. We access browsers, right? Chrome, Google Chrome, Firefox, Opera. So you actually access with some URL and to the, you access the, with URL, you access the server. And you actually perform the task whatever you want. That's what we call it as web-based application. So server will be running on a remote location and you access the application which is hosted on the server using the URL from your browser, favorite browser. Those are called as web-based applications. And there are another type of applications called mobile applications. So mobile applications are like our mobile apps, whatever we install on Play Store, right? So if you are using Android, so we download like Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, many applications, YouTube, all these are called as mobile applications. So when Jason Huggins was working for ThoughtWorks in 2004, he was working on web-based applications. So he faced this challenge of retesting and regression testing for the web-based applications. That's how the idea came in and he developed Selenium. He developed Selenium in 2004 for actually automating the web-based applications. That's the reason. So if you see Selenium like is used to, Selenium is like can be used only to automate web-based applications. And also Selenium is an open source application, meaning you don't need to actually buy the license for this. Before this, there were many tools like to automate desktop and Windows applications which require license, but like to actually automate web-based applications, we can use Selenium, which is a completely open source, meaning it's free. You don't need to buy any license. Anyone can download it and can use it to automate the application. You don't need to pay for it, or you don't have a pro version, or you don't need to buy any license for it. So so completely we can call it as Selenium is a open source. And Selenium is a, as I quoted in the beginning, Selenium is a collection of components. So what are the different types of components? So learning Selenium is like learning all the components of the Selenium. So what are the different types of Selenium components are IDE, RC, and GRID. So we have different components. So you need to learn IDE. IDE is a plugin tool where we can record the steps, whatever you perform, and we can playback. This can be used to actually automate some prototypes or a small actions can be automated using IDE. Then there was RC. Now it is not there. It has been deprecated. It's no longer supported. That's called remote control, where the actions can be executed using in medium called JavaScript. So then came WebDriver. So this is the most widely used component. And whenever someone says that they are using Selenium, or someone asks you that where you know Selenium, they are mostly talking about WebDriver. So WebDriver is an API which can be used to automate the web-based applications. And next is like GRID. GRID can be used to actually execute the scripts on distributed environments, multiple environments in parallel. So that's called GRID component. So this is the introduction of Selenium. Now let's see, as any tool, Selenium also has like advantages and disadvantages. First, let's see what are pros of Selenium. So first of all, as we saw, it's an open source. So that's the main advantage. If you see any tool, it will be having a pro version, or it will have a licensed version once you use it for a trial for 30 days like that, right? So, but Selenium, you don't have that issue. So it is completely free. You can use Selenium anytime, you can use it like for the automating for years too. So you don't need to pay for it. And the other advantage is Selenium supports multiple operating systems. So this is the main advantage of Selenium. So it supports multiple operating systems like Windows, Mac, Linux, and Solaris as well. Also, Selenium supports multiple browsers. So Selenium today supports like almost all the browsers which exist, like main browsers, Google Chrome, Firefox, Opera, Safari, etc. So many browsers are supported by Selenium. And Selenium also supports programming languages. This is also main advantage. So say for example, you only know Java. So then you can actually Java. Then with that programming language, you can actually use Selenium. So Selenium supports many programming languages. It supports Java, it supports Python, C Sharp, Ruby. It supports Perl, PHP as well. So this is the main advantage again. So you can learn any programming language of your choice, and you can start using Selenium. So these are the pros of Selenium. And like any tool, Selenium also has some cons. So the limitations, what are the limitations of Selenium? So Selenium, actually, it can't automate, like you can't, Selenium is a set of libraries. So libraries is again collection of classes that we will discuss in the coming classes. So for now, just think of like Selenium can't actually do everything on itself. Say for example, the reporting for your test cases can't be done. So we depend again for some third-party applications like TestNG reports or extent reports for getting the reports of your test cases which are executed. And if you also see, Selenium was only web-based applications. So you can only automate web-based applications. So you cannot automate other desktop applications or Windows applications. Cannot be used for Windows applications. I can put it as Windows applications. And it can't actually read the Excel sheet. So we said like the automation tool can be used for retesting to read the multiple test data from the Excel sheet, right? So it can't actually read the Excel sheet as is. So we again use a third party tool called Apache Poet to do that. So though Selenium doesn't support these things, it can be like achieved using third party applications. Even here it can't be used for automating the Windows applications, right? So Windows applications here are like, so when you are automating web-based application, there can be you click on some browse to just upload a file or to download a file, then to upload a file, right? So a Windows pop-up will be there, Windows window gets opened, right? So in that case, you can't actually automate using Selenium that Windows. So again, there are tools like AutoIT and Siculi. These are like third-party tools which we can use to automate that Windows applications. So these are some of the cons of Selenium, like and also like you can't actually automate graphs using Selenium. So graphs are like varying things, right? So it graphs actually vary according to the data. So you and it is not like static to automate it. So this is another challenge, and also CAPTCHA. So you can't actually automate CAPTCHA. CAPTCHA is thing which actually is used to identify, system identifies you whether the action is done by a human or it is done with by a machine. So that's the use of CAPTCHA, right? So even the CAPTCHA can't be automated. Even actually automating like CAPTCHA itself is like would be a vulnerability. So it even like Selenium can't achieve automating CAPTCHA. So these are the different cons of Selenium. Also, it can't actually automate applications developed with AngularJS. AngularJS is a Java framework, so you can't actually automate AngularJS using Selenium. For that, we again use another tool called Protractor, which is a BDD tool. So these are the different types of cons or limitations, we can call it, as for Selenium. But if you see, each of them can be achieved again with any other third party tool. And let's now discuss like what are the different types of Selenium releases or versions. So Selenium has different versions. So it came up with the first version. So it has many builds in the first version. So in the first version, IDE was supported for Firefox browser, and then as I said, there was a remote control which was used earlier. It is now deprecated, and grid. These were the three components supported in Selenium one version. And if you see, there is another version called Selenium 2. So in this, IDE was supported for Firefox and Chrome as well. So IDE, as I said, it's a plugin tool just to play record and playback. So as it comes as a plugin or an extension for the Chrome, so you can actually install it in your Firefox or Chrome. You can use it for only the two browsers. And in Selenium 2, RC has been deprecated, and then came the web driver. This is the most important component in Selenium. So as I already discussed, so whenever someone say that Selenium, they're talking mostly about web driver. And also grid was grid we already discussed. So it is used for automating in the distributed environments. Then we had like Selenium 3 version, where like this in the 2 version only still Firefox was introduced, but in 3 version Chrome was supported as a plugin. And again, 3 has like many versions. So Selenium has like many minor versions. Whatever we call it, the first number is called major version. And 3 dot, if there is something called 3 dot some number, that is called minor version. So Selenium supports many minor versions in the 3 release. And currently, the latest stable version is like 3.141 dot something. And latest, Selenium also introduced some new version called 4. Which is still in alpha. So we call it as alpha, as it is still in testing. So even Selenium guys are actually testing that, but they actually release it just to know the issues reported by the users before it is actually released as a stable version. So currently Selenium is using alpha, for alpha. We can also go to the Selenium website. So if you type selenium.dev, so this is the website of Selenium. So as we discussed, the main components are Selenium WebDriver IDE and grid. So these are the main components. And if you go to downloads, you can actually check what are the different types of programming languages supported by Selenium. So it supports Ruby, Java, Python, C Sharp, and JavaScript. And you can see the latest stable version is 3.4.3.1.4.1.5.9 is the minor version. So this is what the Selenium current release is. And this is what all about Selenium is. And mostly why Selenium is has become more popular is, first reason is it is open source. So entirely it's a open source, it's free. So, and if you see here, it supports multiple operating systems. So it doesn't limit itself to one operating system. It actually supports many operating systems. It also supports multiple browsers. So you develop, so if you want to certify your product on different browsers, so you can use Selenium scripts. So you write your script only once, but you actually execute the same script on multiple browsers, and you can certify your software or product easily. And it, as it supports multiple programming languages, so you can learn, you can choose, you have a chance of like choosing the programming language of your choice, and then you can learn that programming language. And learning programming language is definitely mandatory. At least you need to learn one programming language to start using Selenium. And as discussed already, so we in this course will be using Java, as Java is most widely used, like with the combination of Selenium. Although Python nowadays is becoming like in the latest technologies like machine language, artificial intelligence, data science, Python has been used, but this is just now latestly growing. But Java is already established. So when someone is talking about Selenium, they mostly like automate using Java. But still you can learn any other language and still use Selenium to automate your application. But in this course, we'll mainly focus on Java. So Java again is like, it's a programming language, and we can call it as a like ocean. It has like many features. So we can't actually learn everything in Java, but we'll learn in the coming 2 weeks, we'll learn the basics to start with Selenium. Whatever required for Selenium, that we'll definitely learn, and then we'll start using Selenium. As we don't need like advanced concepts in Java, which are like mostly helpful for the developers. They learn it as they actually develop complex applications. Those are like advanced concepts, but we don't need it. We'll just concentrate on the basics which are required to start the Selenium testing. All right, so this is what all I have for this session. Like we discuss, if you see, like we discuss what software testing is and what are all like different types of testing we have. And we also saw like what are the different challenges in manual testing, and how like automation tools work. So in here came like we saw like any automation tool to work, it needs like we need to learn programming languages, what we learned here, and how automation tools can be useful to overcome the manual testing challenges. We covered this, and we also saw a brief introduction of Selenium. And we discussed like different advantages and the limitations of Selenium, and why it became popular. We already discussed like it supports multiple browsers, operating systems, and it supports multiple programming languages. That's the reason it has become more popular, and as it has more demand in the current market, as it is like open source, it is free. So if you like, these are the different topics we discussed like in brief about Selenium. So are you guys clear on this, like till now, the topics, before I move on next to the agenda? Just you can put your responses on the chat window. So if you have any question also, you can put it on the chat window. So I see Srinivas, what is prerequisite skills? Dorababu asks, what is the prerequisite skill for this course? Yeah, as discussed, we need like Java. We need to learn any programming language, but this course mainly talks about like, in this course, you will be learning Java. And that's a prerequisite to start this course. Can you should that you're going to cover syllabus? Yes, sure. That is what we are going to cover. That is what I'll be showing you what we'll be covering in this course. Yes, clear, pretty much clear. Fine. So Dorababu also says Python. So you know Python. So you can actually automate Selenium using Python as well. But in this course, we will learn Java. Should we create frameworks for using Selenium? Yes, we'll also, yeah, Sharat. So we'll also create frameworks for Selenium that we'll cover. So we are not yet completed. So we'll, in the agenda, that only the topic of the brief introduction of Selenium is covered. So next we'll see the general things, what you'll learn in this course and what you'll get in this after each session, that we'll see now. What else should we learn along with Selenium? Yeah, that we'll cover. Can you give just to hear it again? Yeah, sure. So this session will be recorded, Vibhuti. So maybe this will be shared. Difference between Selenium and Eclipse IDE. So Lakshmi, so Selenium and Eclipse IDE, those two are different. In the coming sessions, we'll actually discuss more like what Eclipse IDE, installing Eclipse IDE, what Eclipse is, what Java is. In the coming sessions, we'll discuss that in detail. So maybe you're asking questions which I supposed to be like covering in the next topics. For now, let's continue with this. And I think mostly your questions will be answered when I complete these two lines. So what you learn from this course? So let's see that. So as we already said, you will learn Java with Selenium. So this, in the first session, we already said like we already saw the overview of testing and automation. From the next session, we'll learn Java. So as discussed, like Java might take like 10 classes, 10 to 12 classes. So we'll mainly concentrate on the basics of Java, whatever are required to start Selenium with. And then we'll learn Java concepts, OOP concepts. So this both module 2 and 3 might take two weeks. We'll concentrate on learning only Java in the two sessions. Don't worry, I'm again saying, like, even if you are new to programming, don't worry, I'll start from very basic, and you'll learn Java in like within 2 weeks if you actually follow the classes regularly and do the assignments whatever you are assigned to. And next comes is module 4, Selenium WebDriver. So here we'll actually discuss about Selenium, what are the different types of locators, how to identify the different elements, and how to automate or how to use the different types of Selenium WebDriver. All this will be covered in this module. Next comes TestNG. So TestNG is a framework. So where we have different annotations, where we can actually control the test cases in which order they have to run, and executing the test cases in parallel, and reporting. This can be covered in the TestNG. And next comes reporting. So we also will cover like extend reports and POM. We call it as page object model. This is where the place where we cover the frameworks. So this all comes under framework. So next comes Maven integration and automation. If you see Jenkins, GitHub, Maven, these are all like Maven and Jenkins, GitHub. These are all topics related to continuous integration. We'll go through this as well, and we'll learn more in the coming sessions. And if you see the automation frameworks and a project will also be covered in one of the modules. Once we are done with this, for one session or two, we'll discuss the frequently asked questions, and we'll also help you preparing your resume. So, all right. So this is what you'll learn from this course. And next, what we'll get after every session. So after each session, will be recorded. So once the session is done, you will be shared this recorded video. And whatever we are writing in the class notes, right? Whatever I am putting it in Notepad. So that will be shared, or sometimes I'll be using PPTs that will also be shared. And while writing, once we start with Java Selenium, we'll start writing the programs. So that programs or code snippets will also be shared, and you'll be assigned assignments. After each session, if there are any assignments, we'll be assigning that assignment. So once you are done with assignments and you listen and you follow regularly the sessions, I'm sure you'll be like good with Selenium to do and to start framework with, or also you can easily crack job, as we'll also share the frequently asked questions at the end of the session. So these are the different different things you will be shared after each session. And let me see some questions. Difference between Python, so I'll go with Python. To assign project to do, yes. So yes, Ulla. So we'll be also discussing about one e-commerce project. You'll also be having hands-on on that. Is there a lifetime support will be there? Yes. So this recorded videos. So you have Raghu, you have lifetime support. That's right. That's correct. Vibhuti, don't leave without giving the SS. I have to make notes. Can I learn QA testing without any computer software background? Yes. So before start, this is freshers, Vibhuti. So even I'll start from very basic. I hope you are clear on today's topic. So if it is clear to you for the today's topic, mostly you can learn slowly. You can learn the programming language, and you can even learn Selenium as well. Is assignments graded, Ulla? So you actually do the assignments, and you I'll share on Drive one folder. You can put it on the assignments. So whenever I have time in the weekend, so I'll go through your assignments. So yeah, it's free, Dora Babu. Is there a group project? Or it's a group project. We'll be discussing in one or two sessions the project and the frameworks. So interacting is Raghu. So you can daily after the session of 40, 45 minutes or 1 hour. So mostly the first 1 hour or 1 hour 15 minutes will be the topic, and the next 15 or 20 minutes we'll go through the questions. Once you have if you have any questions on the assignments, or if you have any more questions, that we'll take it up at the end of each session. So how many total sessions are it will take around 6 to 7 weeks to complete all the curriculum, all this curriculum. I hope you are good. So let me actually stop the recording. I can take the questions still, but let me stop the recording.